Oh boy, I got nothing. This episode shut my brain off. I skipped this episode the first time I watched the series through, and I'm so glad I did. Guess what? It's another garbage story about nothing where nothing happens. And guess what? It's a Hamner story! Let's just get through this, okay? Well, I've got a bit of sanity left. Maybe it'll be good for a laugh.
They are?
No, I don't know.
Strange type for this neighborhood. And you stay away from them, young lady.
How's that it, boys?
Yeah, man, that's it.
Ain't you got any furniture, any chairs or rugs in?
Man, I said that's it.
Okay, Mac, okay.
We got work to do.
Black Leather Jackets was directed by Joseph M. Newman and written by that most famous of authors, Earl Hamner Jr. We're doing nothing of any particular consequence with... I actually would argue that the episode stars no one. But I suppose the two people we're supposed to care about are Ellen Tillman, played by Shelley Fabares, and Scott, played by Lee Kinsolving. The former is a young girl who falls in love with Scott, and the latter is an alien who falls in love with Ellen. Great. So the plot, or at least a big part of it, is an alien learning how to love. Please, kill me now. The moment the episode begins, it wastes no time in making the audience hate it. Three guys on motorbikes drive around for like 2 minutes of runtime, underscored by what sounds like a Steppenwolf B-site. That joke was for the Canadians. Anyways, they buy a house, hire a couple of blokes to move some metal boxes, and then demonstrate their telekinesis by lowering the blinds. And yes, laughable, irrelevant uses of their power continue to get used throughout the tale. We have to wait until the 7-minute mark before something happens. Though something happens is perhaps generous. The couple living next door, so Ellen's parents, are watching a sitcom when suddenly the television goes fuzzy and the lights start flickering in their house. The father, opening the window to check the television aerials, notices some sort of satellite dish on the neighboring house and blames that. He marches next door, and the door opens on its own. He wanders into the completely unfurnished foyer, and the three jacket-wearing schmuckheads walk out so in sync, I thought they were going to start dancing. God, I wish it was anything remotely as entertaining as that. They start pushing him around because whatever.
Now, you boys don't happen to be ham radio operators, do you? What's so funny?
Big Daddy wants to know what's so funny.
Who are you boys, anyway?
We are monsters, Daddy-o.
We came from outer space.
Take us to your leader. Just a minute,
I didn't... Cool it, Daddy-o, or I'll disintegrate you with my ray gun.
Now, you...
Look at this cat
Wait a minute!
I'm gonna get the police on you fellas. And I'm gonna call my lawyer. You're gonna be sorry that you did this. Forget it.
Ha 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 ha! Sorry, was I supposed to be intimidated or upset? Because that was hilarious. At least I felt an emotion other than pure contempt, as fleeting as it was. Any hope that this was a purposeful comedy was dashed by two things. First, there is no way Hamner could write a comedy. And second, the following scene. Late in the evening, one night, Ellen misses her bus, and who should find her alone and busless but one of our intrepid alien bikers, Scott. They exchange a dialogue scene that sounds like they just read the script for the first time. No joke, the dialogue is fine, but the delivery is some of the worst I've ever heard on this program. Everyone sounds like they were either forced into the role at gunpoint or didn't give a rat's fart about working in the industry ever again. Anyways, blah blah blah, and she gets on his motorbike and they roll off towards the library. Except not really. She directs him to the park across the road so she can walk and sit with him a while. There have been a few overnight romances explored in the series, and while they do happen in real life, it's always sort of a tug on threads of believability. But at least, even when it's cheesy, there is an obvious and inspired passion. But here, it's flatline. Also, if you don't value your sanity or time and decide to watch this, you'll discover that the biker blokes go back and forth between talking normally and talking like surfer dudes. I think the point was to show that the aliens were having a hard time with the language, or at least the colloquialisms. But this particular idiosyncrasy gets dropped partway through, so I guess Hamner just forgot. Speaking about forgettable, let's get to the next scene. Scott's partners are checking in on him.
Trust our brother.
What has he done?
Formed an attachment here with one of the people.
What kind of attachment?
I'm not sure yet. He's with a young girl in spite of our orders.
Proceed without him.
Good. We've been in touch with all units.
The second wave has landed successfully and is concealed as planned. With the landing of the third wave, we will be in key positions throughout the country.
Excellent.
The people, are they suspicious?
Not a bit. They're a stupid race, as our research told us. An inferior breed given to killing, hatred, making war, greed, and cruelty to one another. The universe can well do without them.
You will receive your instructions for the final move in a few days.
This is embarrassing. Did they run out of budget and could only show the bloke's eyeball? Or did someone actually think this was cool? Because it's not. It's the opposite of cool. Not cool. So finally, more than halfway through the bloody tale, we find out what these three numbskulls are doing. They're a part of a Ford infiltration force, apparently one of hundreds across the globe, who are here to eradicate humanity so they can use Earth as a colony. To do this, they will poison the water reservoirs of every city on Earth. I have so many questions right now. But I'll limit myself to the ones that aren't variations on. Can I leave now, please? First, how are aliens from a distant star, as Scott says at one point, able to perfectly adapt to Earth environments but don't need water? Second, does this bacteria allow them to drink the water, or is there just going to be poisoned water everywhere? Third, if they're advanced enough to travel all the way here, couldn't they have come up with a more efficient plan? If even one team blows it, they could be retaliated on. Fourth, if they were supposed to be inconspicuous, why did they ride in on big burly motorbikes and act really odd every chance they got? Fifth, can I go now? Please? Sorry, I said I wouldn't do that one. Scott, having fallen in love with his girl and realizing that humans aren't all bad, tries to convince his comrades to stop. That doesn't work. So then he tries to convince Ellen to leave the Earth with him. But that doesn't work either because duh. She thinks he's crazy and runs back home and tells her dad. The father calls the cops, and the cop that answers just happens to be one of the alien agents. Huh? So they infiltrated the police? Why? What tactical advantage would there be to infiltrating a Joe Blow police station in the United States somewhere? Whatever. The cop drags Scott away and the episode ends, mercifully.
There's no more time.
Come in, son. Tell us all about it.
Don't listen to him. He's one of us. He's with the advanced unit.
Advanced unit? What kind of advanced unit, son? They told me you were ill, son. So I took the necessary precautions.
No, no! Don't fight them, son.
It'll only make it more difficult for all of us. Folks, we'll take good care of him. Someday, I'm sure he'll thank you.
Portrait of an American family on the eve of invasion from outer space. Of course, we know it's merely fiction. And yet, think twice when you drink your next glass of water. Find out if it's from your local reservoir or possibly it came direct to you from the Twilight Zone.
And that's Black Leather Jackets, a horrible episode about nothing. I hated every moment of it. And I'm not sure what's worse, the fact that this episode exists, or that it's not the worst episode in season 5. It gets a bloody 0.